Yeah, Eric, what's up, buddy?
Nothing much, man.
Hey, did you have a good Veterans Day, man? Thank you for your service.
Yeah, actually, it was really cool because the Marine Corps birthday was the day before.
Yeah, I saw that.
Oh, yeah, so, you know, my wife, she always goes overboard with the Marine Corps birthday. And it was kind of a letdown because we were actually supposed to attend a Marine Corps ball, which we hadn't been to in, you know, 10, 15 years. And so we were going to go, me and the owner and his wife and one of our other executives. We were all in the Marine Corps, so we were going to go to the Marine Corps ball. So we ended up not being able to really go and take advantage of that. But we were hoping maybe next year we'll be able to do something.
Yeah, well, that's cool, man. Well, again, thank you for your service, man. It's exciting. It's a big week. Big week. What's up, Juan? Juan made it. Juan is on time. Yes.
Made it.
Victory. It is a victory. Excellent. Coleman, what's up, buddy? How are you?
Hey, doing well. How about yourself?
Good to see you, man. I feel like I haven't seen you in about a month or so. You're like a once a monther, which is cool. Nobody's
yeah,
good. It's good to see you, though, man.
It's been batshit over here, for lack of a better way to put it. But there's actually one question that I did see, and I really wanted to ask you what came up. There was a topic that I think was talked about a couple weeks ago between Tupac and Biggie.
Yes.
Who came out on top?
Tupac, of course.
Yeah, okay. I'm a West Coast love guy myself, so I'm on board.
Yeah, no, it was good. We had a good conversation. There were some people were like, what are we talking about? But, you know, it was good. It was legit. Okay. We had a good talk about it. But, yeah, I think I like Biggie. He's entertaining.
Yeah.
But I felt like Tupac was entertaining and, like, meaningful. Like, that. Yeah. You know, I feel like his lyrics to me still are, yep. are pointed for today, which is really impressive. So, anyways, it's
great. He's still hiding out somewhere out there, so.
He's probably putting out new music. I don't know how that happened. But, you know, it's pretty crazy. Greg Roberts, what's up? Justin Shepherd, good to see you guys. John Sutton.
Good afternoon.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good. And Nick's on the call. Nick, what's up, man? How's Scotland? Is the you getting typical weather now? You getting the rain? You getting you're live? What is that? What does that mean? I'm live?
I'm just in the restaurant.
Oh, you're in the restaurant. Oh, well, tell everybody we said hi. Do you have your butt? Yes. Earpods in or the
no, no, it's like it's open.
Oh, excellent.
It's my mother-in-law is the chef.
That's your mother-in-law. Oh, excellent. I feel this is a big day. We're meeting the family. This is like, you know, we've really made it now.
This is commitment.
This is big time. We're in now. Oh, that's funny. So we got some new people with us today. First of all, we got Ben Kowalski. Ben, what's going on, buddy? How are you?
Doing well, guys. Nice to meet all you gentlemen.
Ben does a podcast called Freight 360. Has anybody heard this podcast before? Mm-hmm. Or heard of it? All right. So Ben, tell us about Freight 360 because people don't know.
Yeah, actually, I mean, it was geared on a lot of sales stuff, primarily freight shipping. Used to be called the Midnight Freight Broker, but we focus a lot on the educational side. But we've been doing some more, I think more interviews. We did a 3-piece series with Crowley. We did an episode with Kevin Hill this week that airs today. It was on niches in freight brokerage and how to really find different avenues and build moats around your business. That's pretty much it. We did one with Baton Logistics actually today that'll air next week. Really good, interesting episode on dwell time detention and what they're doing on the tech side.
Ben, throw the link in the chat. By the way, somebody's got some major background noise in here. But anyways, throw that link in the chat so everybody can see where to go to check it out. Awesome. Adam Robinson, what's up, buddy? Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
You can hear
you. Okay. That was like a complete dead Zoom. And I was like, whoa, what's going on here? What's going on in the background?
I think it's Rhonda.
Uh-oh, sorry. I'm mute.
No worries. Adam, what's up, buddy? Go Longhorns. I think Adam's not with us. That's all right. That's good. Rhonda, how are you?
I am. It's just a phone call.
That's right. There you go. Yeah. Awesome, man. How are you doing, buddy?
I'm good. How are you guys?
Doing good, man. We had a good week last week. The Freightways events I thought went really well. I mean, I can't wait for the live ones. But I thought last week went pretty well. I feel like it's getting it's continually getting a little bit better. You know, it's like you guys are figuring some things out. I thought the content was good. I personally love the green room for what the truck put that coffee down. I got to enjoy that. The yoga was great with Rhonda. You know, she knocked that out, so that was pretty cool. Those have participated, but yeah. it's nice to see it continually getting a little bit better, which is cool.
I think the company's worn out, though. It was a hell of a week, man.
I'm sure. You had the ventures. You had that, you know. And what else do you guys have for the rest of the year? You guys have any more coming up?
Space Waves is a good one, and that's going to be interesting, working with NASA. So I think you commented on Twitter or something about it. But, yeah, that one looks really cool.
Posed the question like 2 weeks ago, will we ever transport cargo by freight, by rocket? And I got laughed at by a couple of people, but I'm telling you, I think at some point there may be a need for that, you know? You never know.
Well, we have Space Force. Military usually drives the first start of logistics and movement. So.
Yeah, that's true. So it'll be interesting to see. I'm looking forward to that one. That will be good. All right. Well, we've got, what was that, Rhonda? Go ahead.
I said I tried to pick you up.
You did. You always help me out, and I appreciate that. I need it. It's good. So this past week, you guys might know, but on LinkedIn, we had some major discussions around tagging and posts on LinkedIn. I think this is one of Nick's favorite topics at this point. And you're either like team tag or, you know, team not to tag. I'm not sure which one it is, but we're going to talk about that and launch a poll. And while we're doing that, we're going to listen to a little bit of Bon Jovi today. So we've got some different tunes today. So I'm excited about that. We're going 80s. 80s rock, 80s hits, seeing what's out there. So this one starts a little slow, but it's going to come up nicely. So go ahead and take the quiz real quick, and then we'll talk about tagging in social media posts. First to name it, who can name it?
Yeah.
Living on a Prayer.
Yes. Nice work.
Come on, I'm going to win that game every time.
You probably will today. I mean, you're the one of the older cats in here. I get it. This is like your childhood, like the prime.
I said it, but I was on mute, so it was just my mouth.
Yeah.
Bon Jovi, you too, Trey.
I was at the roller skating rink to this.
Yeah, you know it. That's right.
Robot. The sad thing is I was past my roller skating days when this came out. I was roller skating to like Queen.
I can see Justin on a couple skate doing Dancing Queen or something like that from ABBA.
No, I wasn't all the way back to ABBA.
Not that far back.
Not that far back.
Nice. Well, I have to say, just while you guys are taking the quiz, I am so guilty of tagging in posts just to increase my metrics. I don't even know if it works anymore, but I've been doing it forever. But it is a way for us to stay connected, you know, because you might not see my stuff if I don't tag you, so you never know. There's good and there's bad. All right, most of you have voted. We're going to shut this down in 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. All right, excellent. All right, results. Let's talk about it. Number one, do you like being tagged on social media posts in general? All of you said yes. Look, Nick, this is in your favor right here. Look at this, Nick. These results are for you, my friend. In general, people like being tagged in posts. Do you like being tagged on social media posts that don't involve you? So here we got a little bit of a split. So 7 yes and 4 no. I hope that all of my word on the street posts, you guys enjoy being tagged on those because it does involve you. But that's an interesting split. So tell me a reason why you don't like being tagged on things that have, like, that you're not involved with. Anyone?
I mean, just personally, and when I say not involved, I mean, like, completely not involved.
Yeah.
Like, if it's something that involves some idea of injury prevention, safeties, like, no matter what that realm is, I'm okay with that. But when it comes to somebody's dogs or, you know, just something that is completely non-relevant to my business life, I don't want to be tagged on that.
So if like Nick, you know, puts a post on there about playing golf in Scotland and he tags you, that you wouldn't like that. That's what crossed the line.
Well, okay, and I'll take that back a little bit too. It depends on who's putting the post out. Because if it's somebody that I know that is putting a post out, then I might engage with that as well. But if it's somebody that's kind of randomly throwing names out there,
yeah.
Then I don't.
I'll say this.
Have you seen this? Sorry, have you seen
this?
Yeah,
Nick, go ahead.
This is what I've seen lately where was actually when this all started, like, kicking off, tagging, not tagging, where I've seen people that I've never spoken to, but they've seen that my name was tagged in other posts, they started tagging my name in posts. And I was like,
yeah.
And that's when I'm on Dooner site.
Yeah. So I'm with you. There, when people start to realize who the kind of like influencers are on LinkedIn, then they start tagging them and you don't even know them. That's when it does get a little bit annoying. I would agree with
Ryan.
That's probably my limit where I'm like, wait a minute, I don't even, you know, like if Nick tagged me, Nick can tag me all day, Chris Jolly all day, I don't care. But yep. There's people here I've never talked to, somehow we connected and now I'm in every one of their posts.
That's a funny question. Who's got the most, like, because I know what a Dooner's got, like, what, over 10,000, like, followers or something like that? I don't know how many.
I don't know. He's up there quite a bit. Let me check real quick. I can find out.
Because I think, depending on, like, where you are, with how many followers you have, and how many people see you as an influencer or whatever it is, like, some of them might read. Like, I've never been up to, what do I have?
You weren't even close, Nick. You weren't even close.
What is it?
17,290.
Exactly. So maybe he comes from a different angle, right? If he can tag random folk like all the time, then yeah, that could get annoying.
Yeah, his LinkedIn notifications have got to be just through the roof. What, Eric? Or who's speaking?
Well, I was saying that.
Oh yeah, Sergio.
That it's my parents or family members usually tend to tag me on things that I have nothing to do with. And I think my family are the people that get me most irritated when it comes to posts that have nothing to do with me.
Yeah, it happens. All right, so question number three. Do you regularly tag people who aren't involved with your posts in order to increase your reach? So Nick is definitely one of the yeses. Eight people say no, though. Eight of you are no. So most of you are pretty respectful of not tagging people. So when you don't – so I'm curious about this. The next question, have you noticed less engagement on posts that don't tag others? We're split there a little bit. Most of you say yes. Yeah, Ron.
You know, it's funny. Like, I really don't tag people unless it's directly related to them, like thanking them or something like that. But I noticed sometimes when I don't tag, I get actually more traction than when I do tag, which is kind of
really weird. Probably because you have great content. See, that's the difference. The rest of us with bad content, we just have to tag, but you have great content. That's the way that works. Chris Jolly's on the call. He's definitely team tag.
What's up, buddy? I love when Chris tags.
I'm actually, you know, it's crazy. I switched it up this week, and just because I saw a lot of people say people only tag for vanity metrics, and that's just entirely not true because everything remained the same across the board.
Really?
I think it's just it legitimately just has to do with the quality of your content. You know, you can't put out shitty content and expect everybody to love you for it. So,
well, yeah, I remember who said it. Who said, "Thanks for tagging me," because sometimes, like for example, if like I've been crazily busy like last week, and
I think that was Aaron,
and then you come back on and you got so many notifications. If you weren't tagged, then I would have probably missed.
Yep.
Yeah, that's I think Aaron said that on your post. Yeah. Juan, what were you about to say? You're going to say something.
When I post something as like, it's very that it's like, I sat down and I had like a thought that I thought worth sharing. So it's not like I tag people. Like if you like what I say or not, just like, you know, hit the like button. If not,
well, see, Juan, here's the problem, you know? Juan. I haven't seen any of these thoughts that you've posted. So
that is the downside of it, for sure. Like, since I don't tag anybody, I'm not, like, going into anybody's visibility. But if you have me there on your feed and you happen to pass by.
Well, that's the algorithm that keeps on changing, isn't it? Because before the reach, like, when was it? Like, March, April? My reach was, like, mad. And then it switched, and all of a sudden I got, like, literally, like not even a quarter of my reach.
Yeah,
hitting the second and third connection.
We need a contact as a LinkedIn insider who can tell us the algorithm changed. That's what
they won't be. They won't be able to. But it recently changed again.
Yeah,
like I think within the last 2 weeks, it changed again.
Yeah, what's that one?
It out evolved them, and they no longer know how it works.
Well, I think to that point, I mean, if anyone's like, that's kind of why I appreciate tags and see why other did is that like nobody knows if anyone's going to see anything or if the algorithm is going to show it to anybody. And it's like, if you want to start a conversation or get someone else's insight, Yeah. You don't know when you post that if it's getting buried or if anybody's going to see it. Like, to Juan's point, like, I haven't seen it. He probably pulled out some great stuff. But how do you know? Like, does anyone have time to search for everybody every day?
Yeah, that's true.
Or how about this? I have a question. Do any of you notice if you're using your laptop versus your phone? I see completely different.
Really? I have not. Yeah.
I'm going to have to look into that. I love that, those type of queries.
I haven't noticed that, but I might be upset if that's the case because I am missing one stuff because I'm not using my phone.
That's the same when you look at a holiday on a laptop and your phone, all of a sudden the price goes up. That kind of stuff, right?
That's right. Okay, last one. Which social media platform is your favorite? Overwhelmingly, you guys chose LinkedIn. Twitter got some love, and Instagram got two. Adam Robinson, are you with us still? What is your favorite social media platform? Are you muted, Adam Robinson? Can't hear you. Are you muted still?
He's muted, and he's still talking.
Are you muted or unmuted? Oh, okay, he's on a call. Whatever. Okay, so
That hand move looked intense.
So who are the Instagram lovers on the call? Who's Instagram people?
I legitimately just – I didn't have a time. I joined too late to vote, but I think I'm going to be all about Instagram now. Like, I figured out the stories thing this morning for the first time. I'm like, this is fucking great.
Nice. Okay, so Chris is one. Coleman is one. Who's the other Instagrammer on here? Who else likes Instagram?
But Instagram for professional or personal?
Professional.
Oh, Chris is all professional. There's no personal with Chris. Yeah. It's all business. Man. It's all business.
Come on, bud. Hard part.
When I was selling quilts, like, often, selling a couple, like, a month or more, Instagram, that was where I put everything. Okay. And I just started getting so many requests. I think is a good place to, like, put pictures where people just can swipe through pretty fast without.
All right, so let me ask you three this. So Eric, Coleman, and Chris, what is the real advantage and benefit of Instagram? Like, how would you sell somebody that they should use that platform?
I mean, I chose it for a personal reason. I was going from the personal aspect of things, but in terms of, I'm just a really visual person. So kind of like Eric said, right? I mean, there's so much stuff going on a LinkedIn page at any given time. If you're scrolling through Instagram, it's just one focus at any given time. So granted, you have to catch somebody's attention pretty quickly, but if you can do that, it just helps so much more. I feel like it decreases the clutter of everything that's on there.
I think it's easier to single out the people you actually want to follow, because on LinkedIn, you can connect with people, but it doesn't actually pull up your connections content. On LinkedIn or on Instagram, if you're following them and you do like an Instagram story, it's all at the top of your page.
All at the top. Like,
if I wanted to see Trey's or Nick's post, I can scroll over and click on that right away, and that pulls up all of
LinkedIn content. Mobile is doing that with stories. LinkedIn Mobile does have that up top, you know, on the story but side. But it's different. It's different, but they do have that. Yeah. Yeah,
why did they go down with that stories thing? I think that was like horrible when I saw it. My OCD just goes like, I need to see them.
They know this, Juan. They know all of this. That's exactly what's going on.
I was just gonna say, we were really focused on Instagram the first year in our podcast, and we got a much larger following. The problem was the responses we got were like buried. So any legit leads might have been like 2 out of 50, right? So we were getting like 50 to 100 people reaching out, and then like 90 of them were people that weren't even in the industry that just saw a picture and then responded. Mm-hmm. So it just was like super ineffective to use as a business tool. But to everyone's point, the reach was huge and immediate because everyone's just like, ooh, pictures. Like,
so I haven't really used Instagram much. I do have a profile, but I haven't used a whole lot. But it sounds like to me that Instagram is really good for like branding, like getting attention, getting eyeballs, getting something out there, but not so much for interaction or lead generation, that kind of work. Would that be accurate?
Yeah, I would say so at least.
Yeah, okay. I mean,
Chris, I'll be interested to see how you use it.
I'll let you know. Yeah, I mean, yeah. I'm honestly not sure, because it's like, I just think that, you know, our industry specific is such an untapped market with social media. Like, there's, I mean, no matter what, there's still so much market share that anybody can capture in any industry, really. You just legitimately, like, you know, I was just asked this the other day. What advice would I give? Just be consistent. Like, it doesn't matter. Just be consistent. Put it out. Don't worry if it gets 2 pieces of engagement or fucking 1,000. It doesn't matter. It's the message. It's just be consistent out there. And if it's something that's worthwhile, people will stick. If it's not, the best thing about it, change it up.
Like, yeah, you'll get instant feedback.
That's like what Benjamin was saying, right? Like, you can get a thousand people like liking your stuff or like engaging with it. But if none of them are eventual customers, then it's great. It's like, that's then a vanity thing, isn't it? Oh, it's been liked. But if no one is selling your service or product, then okay, great.
Yeah, it seems like a great strategy for long-term marketing strategy, kind of what it sounds like, which is really interesting.
The algorithms change all the time, you guys. You know, that's the thing. It's like, so to put it into context, all of my videos that I have been posting were gaining anywhere from 1,500 to 2,000 views every single day. Now, after the algorithm changed, it's like 180 to 200. It's slowly building back up.
Interesting. So
it's like,
interesting.
You got to get past that, though. Like, it's always going to boil down to the consistency factor.
How do you
like,
do that, Chris? How do you do that?
What's that?
How do you do that?
Do what?
How do you build it back up?
Yeah.
Just keep putting it out there every day.
Keep going.
Yeah.
Honestly,
it's
keep pushing.
It happens all the time, though. Like, LinkedIn has legit, I swear to God, they've changed their algorithm 6 times in the last 7 months. Like,
I agree with that.
Constantly.
Yeah.
And that's why I think other social media platforms are have a greater outreach, because they don't mess with them nearly as much. Like, I don't know why LinkedIn continues to do that. I think it's because they are going through a branding thing. Like, are we missing out on too many people by only being like business? That's why they threw the stories out there. And you can tell, like, the stories aren't that popular, you know, at the end of the day, like, there's a few people that'll actually do, at least in my network, there's a few that'll actually do it.
Not yet.
But even then, it's usually just like screenshots of motivational pictures. And it's like that. Like, I'll Google that if I want it.
Right. Juan, you were going to say something there.
You'd be surprised, like how many truckers you can find on Facebook. Like, I saw a post the other day. Someone made it like a really nice post, and the heading was like, "How the hell did you get that truck?" And believe it or not, more than one time in like those wildfire situations, I pulled out a truck out of Facebook, out of all places.
Yeah. Owner-operators are huge on Facebook. That's really their platform for sure. If I were selling to that, if I were Anthony Pettit, I'd be all over Facebook.
Yeah, but it has its downsides. It's a very toxic. It's a very toxic forum environment. Like, it can go well, or it could go really fucking bad.
But that's where everything is more paid, isn't it? If you want the reach, within Facebook, if you want the reach, you need to pay, because that's where Facebook ads and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
I have drivers talk shit to me.
Kind of. We've been testing out Facebook groups, Freightbook Carriers Network. We've been working, growing that to try to have some reach and to be able to get engagement amongst each other. I mean, obviously, Facebook groups were really big with rate per mile over a year or two, like 40,000-50,000 members. But then they get so big that then it's very hard to do any real business in it. But we've been testing out that. It's been growing kind of consistently.
Unfortunately, those groups, you start seeing, like, sometimes you see questions that I'm like, if you have to ask that question, you're not meant to get into this business, you know? Like, and then you see all these social dynamics where, like, I can see people just taking advantage of it.
The ones that say, like, how do I get a bond? How do I secure this? You know,
that, how do I open
those
authority?
I've seen those questions. Right.
My favorite response to those are, everybody's like, the few people are like, if you have to ask that, you shouldn't be in this industry. Like, stop.
I tell them that every time.
What is an MC? And do I need one? Diana's on the call.
Sounds, yes.
Hold on. Diana's on the call. Did you shower today? That's the question.
What's I made it.
Yes. Made it.
I can neither confirm nor deny what you just asked right now.
Nice. Well, it's good to see you. I'm glad that you made it. I'm glad you made it for sure. By the way, last question. I didn't put TikTok on here, and I included other to see if anybody chooses it. Is anybody trying TikTok for business at all? Anybody?
We just had that talk with Wayne on, like, because he's, of course, massive in his.
No, Trey. No.
I mean, I've heard, you're seeing people get on it that are trying to do business, but I haven't seen anybody in our industry really, you know, go that direction.
I saw.
Although I do want to see Chris Jolly and I do a TikTok. Chris Jolly, you and I are going to do a TikTok dance next time I'm in Phoenix, man.
I created a TikTok, but like, TikTok for me, it was just too distracting. Like, it was like the shiny ball syndrome for me, because I was like, oh god, here we go. Like, what's next? I had to stop.
Yeah,
I went through the whole lockdown without downloading it. I was like, I'm gonna go down like a man.
Yeah. Speaking of lockdowns,
the same day. That's how quick it went. I was like, no, that's
wow, that is quick, Nick. That is quick. All right. Well, speaking of lockdowns, we've got some things going on here. Now the election is over. It seems like things have switched on a dime. I'm not sure why. I'm not going to comment on that. But things are coming back in terms
on
of
a dime and whatnot. What do you mean? On a dime, I mean, to what?
The narrative has changed really quickly.
The world
like
was my narrative,
like in my neck of the woods, like it went like that. It changed overnight. But we're going to talk about that. I've got a poll launching right now, and we're going to listen to a little Peter Gabriel. Does anybody know who Peter Gabriel is? That's the number one question. I mean, I know Justin does.
Yes.
I don't even have to ask that question. But we're gonna enjoy a little bit of this. Go ahead and take the poll about the quarantine and what's going on. But literally in my neck of the woods where I'm in Missouri, it went from things are not too horrible to we gotta shut everything down. But while you think about that, enjoy a little Sledgehammer by Peter Gabriel. This song right here reminds me of riding my dad's truck in the summer. It's gonna be mid 1980s right here. 8-year-old kid.
It reminds me of my mom cleaning house.
Nice. Isn't it crazy how music can take you right back? I mean, right back. You just smell it.
Casey Kasem. Casey Kasem.
Casey Kasem. That's a name some people from this crowd probably don't know. That's for sure.
Do you guys know that Casey Kasem was Shaggy on Scooby Doo?
Really? I did really? Not know that.
Oh my god.
Random trivia back. Like
random trivia by Justin.
Nice.
That's pretty neat.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty cool. Pretty crazy. This takes me back to I used to ride with my dad in the summer because he was a single dad, and so I would ride in his truck, and then we'd go to warehouses. I'd throw the racquetball against the concrete walls with my glove, and every day at 10 o'clock we'd stop at Quick Trip. We get two of those mini sausage biscuits and the chocolate milk, and that's like this is the music right here that takes me back to being right back in that truck. It's crazy.
Do you get that taste in your mouth when you hear the song of the food too?
I don't know about that.
Like that.
I don't know about that. I mean, I still eat the sausage biscuits from Quick Trip. They've just gotten better. They're a little bigger, a little more of a normal breakfast sandwich now. It used to be like cupcake, like in a cupcake bin, two sausage patties. You throw it in the microwave at Quick Trip. You know, put it in for a minute, pull that thing out, and then you're good to go. So.
Yeah, they definitely upped the quality since that time, for sure.
no doubt about it. Their food is actually legit. Like, I could totally survive off Quick Trip if I had to. Totally could survive off Quick Trip. All right.
It looks like a small grocery store.
It does. They've got a chef back in the area. You can order, you can get the cook-to-order type stuff. I mean, it's really changed pretty dramatically for a gas station. I will pass 4 gas stations to go to Quick Trip. That's what they've done. They have changed the – change the game. So you got them down there in Phoenix, Chris. You know what I'm talking about.
No. We don't have those, the Midwest Quick Trips.
You're on the Midwest Quick Trip. Yeah, those. Yeah,
we don't have the KWIK ones. Those ones are like, I mean, if anybody on the East Coast, it's like the Wawa's of the East Coast.
Yeah. All right, shutting it down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, let's talk about this a little bit. Let me share the results with you guys. So in your area, are you experiencing rising numbers and rising or decreasing or staying the same restrictions? Majority of you, rising cases and rising restrictions. 4 of you, rising cases, no change in restrictions. And 1 of you doesn't even know what's going on in the world. All right, so who is?
That was me.
Christelle, he didn't like any of the choices. He's like, I don't like it. Just no idea.
Depends on what channel you watch.
Chris is on the ground.
That's probably true. Who's experiencing no changing restrictions with rising cases? Who's what part of the country? So, Ben,
South
where are you?
Florida.
South Florida. Yeah, Florida doesn't care about anything. That's right.
South Florida, I don't give a shit.
That's right.
It doesn't
That's
matter.
Right.
It's a wild
but like
west.
We're at South Beach.
Hey, whatever the hell you want, man.
Florida's another world, right?
Have at it.
That's why I'm going there next month, man. We're taking the RV to Florida next month just to get away from all that.
Oh, cool.
Okay, where else? Who else is, what are the restrictions? All right, so Juan, you guys aren't having increased restrictions? I thought they talked about it. Not yet? Okay.
The cases keep rising. No more restrictions. We can't. We just can't. Our economy really? Can't sustain the lockdown. Yeah.
Do you think that's gonna be the case no matter how bad it gets?
I think it's gonna be the case.
In Colombia?
They're gonna go probably go back to the weekends restriction. But
maybe bars or places.
People need to work. People need to work. And Medellin is like the equivalent of Manhattan.
I was having this conversation.
You can go and like places you can go.
It is.
And places you can go work, and it's very tight. So it's
like, absolutely right.
What do we do about it?
I was having this conversation with that's my dog trying to get out of the door, by the way. The bank, that's my dog. I'm not now he's look at this, he's I guess he got stuck in here. My wife got him finally. Anyways, I was having this conversation recently with Meshach. You guys know Meshach, he's on this call from time to time. And we were talking about this. It's like at this point, it's like pick your poison. If you don't lock things down, then the vulnerable people are gonna suffer and possibly die. Right? If you do lock things down, people are gonna lose businesses, they're gonna lose jobs. They're not going to be able to pay their bills. You're going to see death because of that. You're going to see abuse because of that. You're going to see mental illness because of that. It's like we have to decide what do we fear worse? What do we you know, dislike the most? I mean, that's really what it's come down to.
Wasn't there a middle ground?
Not right now. There's no middle ground right now.
I mean, it got bad enough to a certain degree down here where banks gave everybody a 3-month period of time to like, hey, don't worry about your debts. Don't worry about your mortgage. Don't worry about your car. Don't worry about your credit card. We're going to wait it off 3 months. And I was thinking the other day, well, I don't think they did that out of the good of their hearts. The reason they did that is that if the entire population goes into a default on their mortgage, their car, and their credit cards, it's going to be a shit show on another level. So it wasn't out of goodness, out of their hearts. It was like, okay, if we let this happen, Moody's is going to tell us, you know, our credit rating as a country is going to go down. This is going to be an entire wreck.
Do banks have a heart, Juan? I don't think they even have a heart. But we haven't seen that here in the States yet. What's that?
We've had these kind of like tiered lockdown system where like you're 1 to 5. 5 is full lockdown, nothing. Tier 4 is like still locked down, but then like restrictions, you can go to certain places. Then 3 is like, that's where we're on now. We just moved from 2 to 3, where bars and restaurants, 6 o'clock closed, no alcohol, nothing, everything else, because that's where most of the cases came from. But what Juan was saying about like, you know, like the 3 months, and we extended it even longer, 6 months.
You guys had that? Yeah, thanks that did that. Okay.
But they just released the tax next year, so everybody's already going up in their tax, so of course it needs to be paid back somewhere.
Right, so no, you're absolutely right about that. Look at the timing of this. Meshach comes in right when I mentioned his name,
right?
It's almost like he heard his name out there in the ether and he's like, I gotta jump on.
Ripping a stogie too. I love
that's great, Meshach. We were talking about the email discussion you and I had about, you know, kind of picking your poison right now, you know, and what do you fear the worst, or what's the worst, you know, case scenario, trying to figure that out. And it's just, there's not a lot of good options right now. That's for sure. Do we know if in the States have any banks or any financial institutions in the States done that in terms of, you know, have you gotten any notices or anything about payments delayed or
default forgiveness?
Yeah, I haven't. I mean, I haven't.
There's a federal one right now. There's a federal with like little individual states. I work a lot in the real estate world, and that's a big issue to what Juan said. And a lot of later on in that question is large default rates. Large, I think the number I saw were 6 million rent payments were missed in October, something like 8 million mortgages were missed for the past 3 months.
Wow.
And the guess is that if another CARES Act isn't passed by February, another 6 million permanent job losses. Permanent.
Wow.
No more.
Yeah, we just can't stop the economy. The entire world would collapse. This is a house of cards. I mean, if banks fail,
at some point there's a breaking point. Yeah, there's a breaking point in this for sure. And it's like that's where it's like, okay, you want to have compassion, you understand that this is dangerous for people, especially who are vulnerable. But what's worse? Nobody can survive. You know, it becomes wild, wild west. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what the breaking point is on that. It's really difficult.
I don't know you guys, but. Another aspect that I'm going to continue to look on, and is like that the companies that did not do anything for their consumers, for example, in my case, like all the financier companies or companies that I saw that are like, oh, they're taking advantage of the situation and just poking like to see what they get out of it. You lost me as a client forever. Like just went down that road, like in that case, because that it really shows the evil side of our corporate capitalist system.
Yeah.
And we gotta be a little bit more conscious of who we consume from, like, and what entities we you know, partner up with.
Yep, and here's a bigger issue to that too, is if a bank can go a year, let's just throw that out there, if a bank can go a year without getting payments from people and they're still surviving, how much money are they making off of us when things are good?
Why can't they go off a year before actually starting to evict somebody out of their house because their mortgage out behind?
Yeah, it's, you know, pretty crazy. All right, next question. Will you take the we got the Pfizer announcement this last week about that. I'm sure there's going to be more announcements like that coming out and moving on that regard. Will you take the COVID vaccine as soon as it is available? 2 of you say yes. 7 of you say no. You're going to wait. And 3, not sure. Somebody in the no department, tell me why you're a no.
I want to grow a 6th finger or something like that a year down the line, I think.
Coleman, that could be really cool, man.
That could be. I want to be an early adopter. Like, I want to see what happens. And if everybody gets healthy without me having to do it, I'm like, I never got it. I'm still locked down.
Yeah, it's interesting. So 2 of you are yes, 3 not sure. Anybody on the yeses of who's the bold ones? Who's the early adopters in this group who are going to take that thing right away? Adam's in, okay. Who else? And Meshach. Well, Meshach, did you vote? I think you were too late for the vote, but Meshach is throwing himself in there as a yes. Very good. Who else? Anyone else? Yeah, it'll be interesting to see the population of how this goes, right? And how they distribute it, how they prioritize it. Is it gonna be self-prioritization? Are people gonna, you know, opt for it? Or are they gonna say, hey, you have these conditions, you need to take it right away? I mean, I'm curious how those guidelines are gonna come down.
Trey, I think we know how it's gonna go down. Like we know, like optimistically, yeah, I'd love to have it come out the way that you want, but we know how it's going to go down, just like it was with all the testing. If you could afford a $500 test, you all of a sudden had access to 1,000 of them, you know? So it's like, it's just one of those things that, you know, money will solve that for you, I think. So.
Interesting. Yeah, we'll see how Paul plays out. 3, will there be a nationwide lockdown before this is all over? 4 of you say yes. 8, no. That will be very interesting in the States because I, as I said from the beginning, I just don't think that the people in America would ever go for that. I mean,
are
that
there
would be
national
like,
voting standards? The Supreme Court continues to let individual states guide their election process, right? So that thing
that's a whole other issue.
I know. I'm just saying as a metaphor, that 10th Amendment aspect, right, yeah, is going to allow the states the power to do what they need best. And it has to be done at a local level anyway, because we can't have a national shutdown. One, we're Americans, we're individualists, it's not going to work. You can't force it. Yeah.
Second, I agree with that.
So second, it just makes more like California's rules versus West Virginia's are going to be different. And so we need to give the locality, municipalities the power to do what they need to do for that specific area. So it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think even if they did, it'd be so hard to enforce. And again, I just don't think that we have the mindset that we would ever go for that. Christy Knitchell is on the call, everybody. Listen up. We are being graced with celebrity status here. Christy, you've won how many awards? Oh my gosh, your office is filled with them. I love it.
It is, awesome. And they're not up yet. Actually, I'm late to the show today because I had to pick another one.
It's awesome.
Glad to be here today. I had some time.
I know. I'm so excited that you're here. It's so good to see you. Love your company, Knitchell Logistics, up in Pittsburgh, up in Gibsonia, not in Pittsburgh, just north of Pittsburgh in Gibsonia. Incredible people, family-owned business. And Christy, how long have you been leading it? Your dad started it, is that right?
Yeah, he started it. I started working for him when I was 19, so I'm in my 24th year.
Yeah. Wow. That's quite a run, an incredible company, and love working with you guys. So thanks for taking the time to join the call today. Always good to see you.
We're talking about
the coronavirus and the lockdowns, the quarantines. What's happening up in Pittsburgh? Are you guys getting restrictions or is it staying the same? What's going on?
Well, so where I live is an hour north of Pittsburgh, and they just did the homeschooling again this week. So just been extended now into the middle of December.
Is that a local thing or is that statewide in Pennsylvania?
No, I think it's just local by school right now. Okay. But I do think that it's going to continue to worse. Our governor's a pretty strict one, so I anticipate some restrictions coming here soon.
Some more coming down. Yeah. Very good. Pittsburgh's one of my favorite cities. I love it. If you ever get to Pittsburgh, if you haven't been there, everybody, and you go and on the south side of the river there, three rivers there, and look down at the city, it's the most one of the most beautiful views you'll ever have. So, and it's got a running path or walk path if you want to do that. So, all right, last question here. How will COVID impact the economy in 2021? So looking at next year, 3 of you say will severely harm the economy, 7 slightly harm, 1 no impact, and 1 slightly help. Most of you say it's going to harm the economy. I think we would agree with that. I'm curious if anybody, whoever said it will help, I'd like to hear that viewpoint. Anybody want to share that? Or you don't have to identify if you don't want to, but if you do, I'd love to hear that perspective since it's contrarian. Anyone? Mom, was that you?
Yeah.
Okay, so talk to me about that.
I think we're going to, from an economic standpoint, we're going to have a hangover. And we're going to be looking at a slowdown the first half of the year.
Okay, so do you think it's
going to... That's where we're going to get the bullet, the entire thing, once it starts clearing out.
Interesting. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how deep the impact is, like we said, if the lockdowns continue. I mean, I know I've got friends here at St. Louis where we're about to do another massive lockdown in St. Louis County who run a small gym. And, you know, like they're in serious threat of not being able to survive. And there's several businesses like that, real restaurants, little small businesses that are going to suffer the most. The big ones can make it, you know, the Michaels of the world, the Hobby Lobbies will probably make it at some point. But the small ones is the ones that I fear of not making it. So we'll have to see what happens with that.
On that note, that's actually something that I've talked to a couple of people about. Like the businesses themselves are struggling, but some of the employees are now flourishing because of it. There was a personal trainer who she worked for Lifetime Fitness, and she ran a class at Lifetime Fitness, was, you know, making a couple of bucks doing it and, you know, paying rent. And my neighbor actually, I found this out because I see him and his wife in the backyard doing some like some workout. And he said that she actually was, because they got to be kind of friends with her and they talked to her, and she started at the end of the, or at the beginning of the shutdown, kind of sending out the emails to the people that she had known and said, hey, I'm no longer with Lifetime, but I'm doing this thing on my own now. You can do they basically did Zoom calls for workouts. She was doing them, I want to say twice a day or something like that. And now it was, instead of funneling through Lifetime where she gets her hourly wage and what have you, now they were just paying her directly. And it was, you know, Lifetime struggled. Yes, it hurt them. But the employees that were now independently operating and that initiative did pretty well. Anybody, I mean, that's what I was actually kind of curious. I was waiting for that question because I want to, like, anybody else hear any stories like that where it's a net even and it's going from the big company, to the individual.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Anybody else hearing that out there?
Tons of it. Small businesses, like business applications, I think are up 70% over last year. So many small businesses, so many people starting side gigs and side hustles. But I think you point out a really great point, Greg, is that, you know what though, you know, it's still getting affected is the commercial real estate market, right? No matter what, you shutter those doors, that property is worth less money. And so much of our infrastructure is levered against that asset, just all of society, right? It's like $3 trillion, the office market. And we are using at least 10% less of it now as a society than we ever have. These are going to get revalued.
Well, just wait. The banks are going to make back their money. They're going to get into distressed commercial real estate, and they're going to make back their money. Don't you worry. So if you have any sort of commercial real estate ties, you should get into distressed real estate.
But what's going to happen with that real estate? Because I don't think some of the offices are going to come back. I think it might change to something else, like maybe come, residential, something like that.
Apartments. It's interesting because we have the biggest problem we have in the country is that we also don't have affordable housing in these areas. Like all of the major cities, we don't have affordable housing. And you're going to lose 10% of this, except we have a code in between that doesn't allow you to just switch from one to the other.
Right.
So it's not just going to go from one to the other. It's going to be interesting.
It will. I'm sure there'll be some exemptions made if that is the case, because it could be a game changer, especially if cities don't come back. You hear about like San Francisco, LA, New York, some of the cities aren't going to come back. You know, and people moved out and they're working remote and they don't want to be there anymore.
Is anyone here in the transport for construction?
We do quite a bit of construction, but not necessarily on the residential side.
How's it going on your end? Because my civilian perspective of at least here in Colombia is that people have been remodeling their houses a lot lately.
That's huge in the States. Home Depot and Lowe's are big right now.
I mean, we're still seeing the same volume, if not more, doing construction, not only in construction, large buildings, larger office space, more so renovations. You know, if I was a family man, I would, if there's any publicly traded excavating companies or buildings that specialize in demolition, that's what I would be into, because I think we're going to see a lot of stuff coming straight down rather than getting, you know, redone.
Yeah, that's probably a good point. I've actually remodeled two bathrooms during COVID. So, and my neighbors, all my neighbors' yards are like looking good this year. You know, everybody landscaped and, you know, had the time to do it. So, oh, we got to pause for a minute. We got to pause. Robert Bain is on the call. Beefcake Bain is here. Come on, man.
Bain, you got to send me a beefcake.
Hey, listen.
I want a Midwest Side barbell shirt so bad.
So Robert, I can give you the story behind that later, but go ahead.
Do you have the video of from your daughter from the competition?
I do. Give me 1 second. I'll pull it up.
I want you to share that with everybody. So for those of you who don't know, Robert's daughter does powerlifting. She's a three-time world champion at the age of 14. Wow. And just competed in another one recently. And Robert, being the proud dad that he has video. He's going to share it here in just a minute. And then we're going to do another poll here after he's done that. So pull that up and share your screen. You got permission, my friend.
I was showing my daughter a picture. And she's 14, and she's like, oh, I know that girl. She's the three-time world champion. He's telling me more about her.
All right, here we go. Aww.
All right.
143 pounds. All right. State champion gymnast.
Oh, it got a little wiggle, a little shimmy. I like it. She got the shimmy. Nice.
Oh, that was awesome. That was the start of her day. That was her third squat. That was a 17-pound lifetime PR, actually.
Wow. Nice. Yeah.
Well, very good. Started the day off well. Learned a very valuable lesson of pre-meet nutrition, because she did not eat or drink anything the day before. And started having back spasms after bench. She did tie her all-time best bench. So basically we got one deadlift in and called it a day, but still obviously incredibly proud of her. She's unbelievable. We actually got word, I think Trey, I was telling you this the other night, we were talking a couple days later, that she has been invited to walk in New York Fashion Week.
Awesome. So, very cool.
It's pretty,
that's cool. That is really cool. Well, share that with us. Share that with us when it happens as well.
Yeah.
So that'll be exciting to see. Very, very cool. That's awesome to see. All right, everybody. So we got a new topic today. Newsletters, if you haven't noticed, have made a comeback. Adam Robinson might be responsible for part of this at the FreightWaves side of things, as they just launched theirs as well. But they're really making a comeback. I mean, remember this, like, newsletters used to be like church newsletters and things like that back in, like, you know, the early 2000s or whatever. And then they kind of went away. People wanted emails and things like that. And now newsletters for business have really made a comeback. So we're going to do a quick poll on that. And while we're doing that, let's listen to, what do we want to listen to? Let's listen to little Billy Ocean. How about that?
Nice. Yeah,
Chris, you know Billy Ocean? Chris, do you know any of these artists we're doing today? We're doing 80s hits today. Are you old enough for those?
Me?
Christy. Madonna.
Oh.
You want Madonna? I'll find you Madonna.
Madonna.
Get out of my mind and into my car.
Damn.
That's a good line, man. All right. So, what Madonna song do you like? What's your favorite Madonna song? You have one?
Surprise, there's no Masters talk.
Whatever you have.
Oh, it's on the agenda. We just haven't got to it yet. Relax, John. Christy, go ahead. What do you got? All right, here we go.
Whenever you got mine.
Little up tempo. Madonna. What song is this? Who can name it quickly? Anyone? Adam, come on. Adam, you know who Madonna is.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, there you go.
That was before I was born.
I'm with you, Juan.
Justin, I think you're muted.
I completely lost you, man.
Unmute Justin. Can't hear you.
Oh, Holiday. That's right.
The Wedding Singers version of it is the best. Right.
That whole album, that whole movie is so good. So good. Probably the best 80s.
If you took a holiday. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Mom was so keen when this was out, bro.
That was
we're shutting down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 All right, let's talk about newsletters. All right, how many newsletters have you subscribed to in the past 6 months? Most of you haven't subscribed to FreightWaves newsletter. What is going on, Adam? You got to put the link in there right now to subscribe to that. Some of you subscribe to 1 to 2, 3 to 4, and then 5 or more. I actually subscribed to a newsletter called 90 Second News, which was a really cool story by a guy who was trying to get a job at Morning Brew. He put together an entire Morning Brew newsletter in 8 hours, and all he wanted to do was get an interview. He didn't end up getting a job there, so he just started his own newsletter called 90 Second News. So I subscribed to that. Morning Brew is obviously pretty big. So those of you that subscribe to, who's subscribing 3 to 4, give us some names. What newsletters are you subscribed to? What's out there? What are the good ones?
I'm on the Hustle and the Morning Brew and then all the Freight Waves.
The Hustle? Is that right?
The Hustle is a really good daily one. It's real similar to the Morning Brew, except it's a little more of satire in the way it's written, but it's like really solid journalism, honestly, and it's got some really great takes on what happened yesterday and the market news and covers every industry. It's really good.
Yeah, yeah. What else? So the Hustle, the Morning Brew, what else? Anyone else?
I have a secret. I don't like them.
Tell us why.
Well, marketers are interesting, right? Like, I don't like Facebook. I don't really. It's like I kind of know how it all works, and it just kind of strips out all of it for me. I don't know, man. I guess I would prefer if I got my information by talking to somebody. I don't know, like. I like to find the people behind the work and then try and get to know them and then get information that way or follow them personally on like LinkedIn or Twitter or something. I just don't like an email like that. And I've already got enough email and I just can't keep up. So it kind of gets lost.
Interesting. Okay, good. So tell me somebody who is for newsletters then, somebody who thinks that they're valuable or worthwhile. Ben, obviously you think they're worthwhile because you read a couple of them. What are the reasons why that is, or somebody else jump in?
So I'll say this. I like newsletters for a couple of reasons. One, I like being able to keep up on stuff. And I typically will spend my Sunday night reading through like either the top five on FreightWaves. I also subscribe to like Inside Logistics, DC Velocity, a lot of like industry specific ones, right? The other reason I like them a lot is when new people come into the industry, whether it's like an SDR or like a new account coordinator, and there's like, I have all these questions about the industry. Cool. I don't have time to answer them all. So let me do this. Instead of just having this general, what's a flatbed, what's a pneumatic, like all this, go and read through these newsletters for a couple of weeks, then come back to me with questions. Let's have a more pointed discussion. And so that to me has been a really big thing. Greg, you remember when I talked about this with a lot of our folks at Quad, that was a big thing. I told people to subscribe to a lot of these newsletters. And I noticed the people that did and started reading them, their quality of work did start to go up.
Interesting. So you're kind of using it more as a training tool and for information for the industry, that kind of thing.
Right. It gets them in this habit of looking at, and then they would start to ask questions like, well, hey, I'm hearing this in the industry. What's that mean for us? Ah, now we're thinking more than just our day-to-day.
Yeah, that's interesting. The one thing I like about newsletters is it seems like the ones that I've been reading, it's just the news without any editorial comment. And I like that because I think we get enough editorial comment in news today. So I like the fact that I can read, 90 seconds, 5 minutes of information, kind of know what's going on, but not necessarily be told how to think about it, and I like that. I tend to prefer that. So that's why I like newsletters. All right, next one. How frequently would you prefer to read a newsletter? Most of you would say weekly. So daily is too much for most of you.
Yeah.
So weekly is ideal. Okay, very good. Number three, would you be more inclined to subscribe to a general newsletter or an industry specific newsletter? Everyone says industry specific. So that's interesting. So I'm not even sure besides What the Truck, what is industry specific? I've never heard of Inside Logistics before. What are the other ones that are in transportation logistics?
Kingsgate sends one out too that I get that's pretty decent.
Kingsgate does? Really? I did not know that.
Yeah, Tom is really, yeah, they do a great job.
I had a study group this morning with Tom. I saw him this morning. I didn't know he did that. I'll have to check that out.
Supply Chain Dives, another good one, Craig.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. Yeah. Supply Chain, I get that.
Supply Chain, is it just called Supply Chain?
Supply chain.
Now I think they have it.
What was that, Robert?
I'll put it in the chat.
Yeah, please do, because I'm not hearing it. Thank you. Good deal. All right, next. For which email address do you typically use when subscribing to an email? Because this is a big deal, because one of the reasons why newsletters are becoming popular is because you get direct-to-consumer contact information. And so that's why they're – I think that's one of the big reasons, the big motivations behind a newsletter is really just to collect direct contact data. So which email do you use when subscribing? Half of you – some of you work, some personal, some of you depends on the newsletter. I think that's the goal, is they're after the contact information. They're after the email address directly. At least I've heard that a couple of places. So I don't know, Adam, what do you think as a marketer? Do you think that that's a, I mean, what's the reason, why did What the Truck create a newsletter? Or what are your thoughts on that?
I think it just is an extension. Like what we're trying to do is personalize content to the individual. And so, you know, you have these people like Andrew Cox, who's not only going to do a newsletter for the retail shipper community, but he's going to do a podcast. He's going to do other pieces of content and vary out the assets, really. As a marketer, my job is to be able to provide a medium for your choosing, whether it's you like newsletters because a certain percentage does, or you like podcasts because a certain percentage does, or you like the long form written word like myself. It's really just about proliferating that content type. But then the movement in 2021 for marketing and for companies to succeed is going to be centering that around a person, around an actual human being. Because we're going to get back to this where we've been automated and spammed so much that we want to develop real, tangible relationships, just an extension of what you're doing, Trey. Everything you're doing is around that, you know, that good logo, and you expand it out and rep lean really, really well. And so I do that myself. Robert does that himself. Ben, with your podcast, we're all trying to do that. But that's why newsletters are going to exist at FreightWaves, and that's why What the Truck got spun up, just an extension of Dooner's mind, right?
Yeah, yeah. So there's a logo, everybody. Lean Marketing created that. So if you'd like your own logo, reach out to us and we'll get that done for you. So no, I think you're right. I think there has to be a purpose behind it moving forward. And Dooner's one of those guys too. He's classic in that regard. So that makes a lot of sense. Okay, last one. Then we're gonna call it. We have to talk golf because it's Masters Week, everybody. So I'm a little consumed with that. It is streaming on my computer all day. I'm still very productive, but it's on there every day. But here's what's interesting about it. This is what I've noticed is new in sports last year. I've never really got into it, but it has to do with placing your bets and sports betting, which has now become a huge industry, a major industry in sports now, even more so than it was in the past. It used to be kind of like a kind of in the dark, only a few people did it, and now it's becoming a mainstream where everybody's betting. And now you have pre-game betting and you have in-game betting, which is really interesting. So go ahead and take that poll real quick. If you don't know anything about it, then just choose one. We'll have fun with it. But I'm excited. You know, Tiger shot 68 yesterday. I was very excited about that until I realized that everybody was shooting 68, so it didn't really matter. So we'll see what happens the rest of the week with the soft conditions at Augusta National. It's weird. How many of you are watching the tournament? Raise a hand. Isn't it weird to see Augusta National without fans? You know, like no fans. Yeah. The course looks completely different. I mean, it just looks weird. You know, I saw a putt on 18 where you could see through it and you could see 1 and 9, where before you would never see that because of the fans. Like, it's so weird to see the course.
I think especially at a place like Augusta National where you see that same course every single year.
Yeah.
You know, the U.S. Yeah. Open is someplace different every year. But Augusta National, you always see that. So you know what it looks like with 10,000 people following Tiger all over the course.
Yeah. It's like weird to see the 18th tee box.
You can see just like four holes at a time. It's crazy.
Yeah, and the 18th tee box usually is lined with people, which is one of my favorite things, because I'm just always wondering, is somebody going to hit somebody someday? Like, is this going to happen? You know, I mean, it's like they're tight. It's like a bowling alley, you know? And then it's not there. So it's like, it's a weird feeling. I wonder what it feels like as a player. If they're just like freewheeling, like, you know, they can hit anywhere. They don't care. Nobody's there. I don't know if it changes in their mind or not, but they ripped that course up yesterday and this morning. So. You know, we'll go with that. All right, let's go ahead and call it on the poll in 5, 4. We didn't listen to any music, but we'll listen to a little more Madonna. I guess we'll throw another Madonna song there for Christy. Give her a little love today. All right, so we're going to end it right now and share the poll.
Robert.
Have you ever bet on
a this Friday feels like a Monday.
All right, so 7 of you have bet on sporting events. 5, no. I have never bet on the sporting event. Can you believe you guys believe that? I've never bet on the sporting event. I almost can't even believe that.
The only thing that I put there was because I've been in NCAA tournament pools.
See, I have two, but I wouldn't really count that. The only betting I've done. That's really betting on my ability to pick random people. That's not. It's different than the actual game.
Right.
So.
I suck at picking random people.
I am good at tagging them though, you know, and LinkedIn. So let's just circle back around to that. All right, which sports are you interested in betting on? All right, so most of you in football, some baseball, some basketball. Six of you said other. What sport am I missing here? What am I missing?
UFC.
MMA.
UFC. MMA. See, I don't follow that too much, so I didn't even think about that. That's a good point. Is it all pre-match betting, or do they do in-match betting? They do in-match as well.
Yeah, they do both now.
Yeah. I mean, that's fascinating.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but most of you, question three, most of you prefer pre-game betting. Most of you kind of prefer that. I think the in-game betting is like for addicts. My goodness. Can you imagine watching a game and just constantly betting on what the next thing is going to happen? You know, is Tom Brady going to throw a completed pass here? You know, are they going to throw a pass or a run? Are they going to score on this drive? I mean, think about all the bets that are out there, you know? I mean,
you used to be able to – I used to go to a buddy's house, and he would have his computer up, and you would be able to bet, is the next play going to be a pass or a run? And they would have instant odds for everything. Wow. And you basically had the play clock to get that call off. Like, Wow. Oh, yeah, well, it's obviously going to be a run, but you're getting, you know, 1-4.
Right. The odds are
degenerate,
worse.
To your point.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's really fast. I mean, it's a big thing now. I mean, I'm watching – I follow Barstool Sports. I follow Riggs on Barstool Sports on Twitter. And he's talking about the bets that he's making. And so he had a bet that Mickelson would make a birdie on 18, and then it didn't go in. Like, talk about engaging people in content. You're engaged the entire time because you're betting the whole time on different events that are going on. I mean, that is keeping somebody locked in to an event, no doubt about it.
Yeah, one sports show that doesn't have that where they end with showing the betting.
Right, or it's on the bottom panel now. You know, where they'll show the betting stats.
Yeah,
on the bottom. Yeah.
Now they'll give you their picks. That's just,
it's huge. It's become huge. All right, last question. Are you up or down overall in your betting career? So I think you guys are liars on this one. I think you're lying. Six of you say you're up a little bit. You don't know. You're probably down. You're like the people in Vegas. Oh, I'm way up.
Yeah. I ain't got that luck.
No, I track mine.
I always win.
I track mine pretty closely.
I bet you do.
And I told my wife that we should take all of our savings out of the out of our retirement and everything, because I'm way better at picking gambling, you know, sports games, than I am at picking stocks.
You're like, let's take that paycheck.
That's
some real money. That's it's not gambling, sweetheart. It's just, you know, it's not gambling. It's science. I've got this.
It's aggressive.
Betting for the future.
That's right. Oh, that's awesome. Hey, everyone, this has been a fun show. Thanks so much for being a part of it. We that hour went by really quick. So excited that some of you joined us. Ben, thanks for coming. Christy, always good to see you. Thanks for jumping in. And I hope you guys have a wonderful weekend. Anybody going hunting this weekend? It's the first weekend of hunting season here in Missouri. Anybody else going hunting? Because I am. You won't see me for 3 days, y'all. Unless I kill something on Saturday morning and then I'm back.
What do you hunt with?
I hunt with a 30-30.
Mm. I would like action. To go, I've never done it, but I'd like to go hunting. Like,
yeah, it's
either crossbow or bow and arrow.
It's my wife's grandpa's gun. He doesn't hunt anymore, and so it passed it down. So it's the one that I get to use. So it's an old, old gun, but it works really well. I've got two so far with it. So
probably a Winchester Model 94.
It might be. You know what? I'll look it up and I'll take a picture of it.
Lever action, that, John Wayne's
it's
gun.
It's total lever action. Yeah, totally. I think it.
Oh, you guys in the picture, man.
It takes maybe 8 bullets at a time, and sometimes I need that many. I think the first one I shot, I took 2 or 3 shots on it. Now, the last one I shot, I took 2. I've never hit one with 1 shot. It's pretty sad.
Oh my god!
I'm not a great shot, people. I'm just letting you know that. But no, everybody have a great weekend. It's so good to see you guys. Thanks for being a part. Can't wait for next week. Got some exciting news next week for you guys. So make sure to come back and invite some people with you. All right.
Good weekend, guys.
Good weekend, everyone.
You too. Bye.
Bye. Bye.